Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Keep, O Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion. For the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I will take a sprig from the lofty top of a cedar. I will set it out. I will break off a tender one from the topmost of its young twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain height of Israel, I will plant it, in order that it may produce boughs and bear fruit and become a noble cedar. Under it, every kind of bird will live. In the shade of its branches will nest winged creatures of every kind. All the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree, I make high the low tree. I dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken. I will accomplish it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord.
And to sing praises to your name, O Most High.
To tell of your loving kindness early in the morning.
And of your faithfulness in the night season.
On the psaltery and on the lyre.
And to the melody of the harp.
For you have made me glad by your acts, O Lord.
And I shout for joy because of the works of your hands.
The righteous shall flourish like a palm tree.
And shall spread abroad like a cedar of Lebanon.
Those who are planted in the house of the Lord
shall flourish in the courts of our God.
They shall still bear fruit in old age.
They shall be green and succulent.
That they may show how upright the Lord is.
My rock, in whom there is no fault.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In today's gospel reading, we hear Jesus tell two stories called parables. Parables are short stories that have a single point. So the gospel reading today is about planting and seeds. So in this brief homily, I want to take a time trip with you. I want to start us in Palestine, Israel, 2,000 years ago. And then I want to move us to New York City, the Bronx, in the 1960s and 70s. And then on to our own day. So here we go, 2,000 years ago. Jesus tells a story about a mustard seed. The smallest seed in the world. And we all know about mustard seeds, about how a small seed and it grows into a mighty plant and so on and so on. One thing about mustard, though, is that while it is a tiny seed, as the mustard plant grows into a huge plant, a vine, it is an invasive species. If you plant a mustard seed in an empty field, in a relatively short period of time, the field will be covered with mustard plants. And once they're planted and established, you can't get rid of them. So while it's a nice story about mustard seed, a small piece of faith, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, et cetera, the rest of the story is that it grows into a plant that you can't root out. It's just there forever. Well, that was the situation 2,000 years ago. Mustard seeds, invasive plants, once rooted in, you can't get rid of it. So now in our time travel, let's move to New York City in the 1960s and 70s, and specifically to a neighborhood, a borough called the Bronx. In those days, and somewhat to this day, the Bronx, at least parts of it, are blighted. Empty buildings, deserted plots of land filled with trash. How do you deal with that kind of blight and depression of living in a setting like that? Well, two ladies, Hattie Carthen and Liz Christie, had a vision, separate times and places, but their vision was generally aligned. And Hattie Carthen decided that she was going to take the empty trash-filled lots in the Bronx and fill them with plants. And Liz came along later, and together they established what are known as community gardens, which exist to this very day. They took an empty lot, cleaned it up, planted trees, put in benches and grass so that people would have a place of respite and relaxation. That was 70 years ago, and there's still community gardens spread around New York City, some 400, 500 of them. In fact, there's a community garden just across the street from the cathedral at the corner of 111th and Broad and Amsterdam. You can go in there, it's filled with plants, there are benches, it's a restful, peaceful place. But Hattie and Liz didn't just plant trees and plants, they invented what was called a seed bomb. And they would take seeds and push them together. And as they walked past an empty lot that was filled with weeds and trash, they would take their seed bomb and just heave it over the fence so that it landed in the yard. And from there, the flowers grew. Well, I wonder, as we move to our own day, what kind of seeds are we planting in our own life and in our own community? And what about the seed bomb that we call the gospel of Jesus? The good news of Jesus is like the mustard seed. Once you hear the good news, once you even try to appropriate it in your life, in the simplest and smallest of ways, once that seed is planted, you can't get rid of it. It's just there, and it grows and grows and grows. So I'm wondering what the seed of Jesus' gospel in our lives looks like. It looks like kindness. It looks like forgiveness. It looks like understanding. It looks like giving hope. It looks like going into the empty lots of this world in our lives and digging around and planting seeds and turning wasted spaces into places filled with life and hope. And we do this in our own relationships with those nearby or far away, through acts of kindness and love and respect and understanding. But then there are the seed bombs. Well, that's what you do with the seed that's been planted in you. Like Hattie and Liz, you make a seed bomb and you walk by the hungry, the homeless, the dispossessed, the victims of racial injustice and disequity, unequity, and you take the seed bomb of the gospel and heave it over those fences and walls. The end result of the seed bomb is, God willing, and God gives the growth, that kindness and respect and hope bloom. The point of the story is this. A seed has been planted in you. That seed needs nurturing and watering and tending. You have to use the seed to be kind. And the root is all kindness. The gospel of Jesus is about being kind. It's about God's kindness toward us, that we can come to the cathedral, to services, worship services, and approach God hopefully and confidently. I know church is a place where people feel like they come to be judged and told, don't do this, don't do that. And that's kind of not my vision of what church is about. Church is a place where sinners come to enjoy a feast, to hear about kindness and hope and what we can do in our own lives. Church is not a reward for saints. It's a place for sinners because God loves all of us as if there were only one of us to love. And all are welcome in this place because all are welcome in God's heart. So the seed of kindness has been planted in you. Now my question is, using that seed and its growth in your own life and soul, are you going out to make some seed bombs in the world around you and the people you know and love and who love you and people you don't like and they who don't like you? Try heaving a seed bomb of kindness and love. See what happens, and a beautiful plant will grow.
Oh.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. Today, all the world's Anglicans are praying for us in the Episcopal Church. Let us in turn pray for them. Let us pray for unity in our diversity. Let us pray for mutual respect among the members of all our 40 churches across the world. Let us pray that we will be faithful witnesses to the living Christ and zealous stewards of his mission. And let us pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, the first among all our bishops, and this cathedral's friend and supporter. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the Church of St. Luke in the Fields, here in Manhattan, held in prayer across the diocese today. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us continue to pray for the end to the pandemic. Let us pray for the scientists and medical professionals who tend the sick and inoculate the hopeful and work to perfect the vaccines. And let us give thanks for all the progress we've made. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all the world in its many nations and peoples. Especially let us pray for the leaders of the G7 nations who today conclude the meeting in England, for Canada and France and Germany, for Italy and Japan and the United Kingdom, and for our own United States. For what other nation should we pray today? Let us speak their names aloud or type them into the chat. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us be mindful of those who suffer in body or in mind or in spirit. Our prayers have been asked this week for Luis Rivera Rivera, Deacon, for Renee Ennis, Kenton J. Curtis, Deacon, and Clyde Hicks, for Diane Aronsoft and the Holly family. For whom else shall we pray today? Let us speak their names aloud or type them into the chat. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray in gratitude for all that is good in our lives. As always, let us give thanks for the generosity of the cathedral's benefactors. And let us give thanks for all the ways our city is coming to life again. For what else should we give thanks today? Let us call it to mind, or speak, or type. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the dead. Our prayers have been asked this week for Ivan Imperator, Lori Bailey, and Kent Smith. And we pray for William Randolph, who was buried from the cathedral on Thursday. For whom else among the dead should we pray? Let us name them in silence, or aloud, or in the chat. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not, or in our blindness cannot ask, grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
May God give you grace never to sell yourself short, grace to risk something big for something good, grace to remember that the world is too dangerous for anything but truth, and too small for anything but love. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Come, be thankful, be what thou is the song.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.